I can't remember the NRC inspector's name. I don't know if you remember it, but there was a particular NRC inspector who went to the Met about the potassium iodide. He had done all this research, and he tried to get the NRC to recommend that this was out there and to put it out there and to get it in every town near a nuclear plant. And because they didn't want to alarm, and this is like 20 years ago, they fired him, didn't they, at first?
I think. Oh, they put him in a corner office for the rest of his career.
Yeah, and didn't let, but he really was a whistleblower in bringing this issue forward, and I'm sorry I can't remember his name off the top of my head, but I really commend his effort.
Well, so far now with this, we're learning that the emergency planning was so bad in Japan that the treatment of the people, that politics went above the concern for the health and safety of the people, and that this was definitely augmented by the oversight agency, NISA, right?
NISA,
N-I-S-A. And now, when you were there, Arnie, were the people aware of all of this when you were speaking to the audiences there, or what?
Well, when I talked to the Japanese Press Club about the close association between Tokyo Electric and their own legislature, there were a lot of smiling, nodding faces. They all recognized that Tokyo Electric is the big dog, and the legislature does what Tokyo Electric wants. You know, the other example is in compensation of victims, which the Greenpeace report talks about as well. They don't have Price-Anderson, which is the nuclear insurance policy here in the United States, where utilities have very little to lose if there's a nuclear accident. Right now, all of Tokyo Electric is on the hook and is likely to be nationalized. But Tokyo Electric doesn't want that to happen, and they're pushing really hard within the legislature to get cash infusions from the state without being nationalized. But the reason they're hemorrhaging is because they've got thousands and tens of thousands of people who need these payments. And yet a lot of them, after 6 months out of their home, they're given a token $1,000 payment to try to make up for the losses.
Mm-hmm. And they have to sign legally that they will never come after any additional money, that they accept the $1,000 as payment covering all their damages. And these are people, families, who have had these farm properties. You know, like Vermonters, they're connected to their land. They've had these farm properties for seven generations, and they've lost their farms. People are talking about, some people in the Japanese government are saying, oh, they'll be back in 30 to 40 years after the cleanup. But it's, you have to take the half-lives. It's 300 to 400 years before this land will be livable again and usable.
And these are the people that had to be evacuated, and also people who evacuated themselves.
Right.
Right.
And they're in a different position also.
Well, if you evacuated yourself, there's no compensation. They're basically saying that's your problem. You didn't have to go. And the ones that did evacuate have to fill out a 60-page form and attach receipts to get any compensation at all. So clearly, at the end of the day, the average Japanese is going to never be compensated for the accident. The other piece of Japanese law is that you can only declare damages up to 20 years, and a lot of cancers occur at 20 or 30 years. So if you get cancer that's now latent but is going to develop late in your life, you can't go back and get compensated for that either.
And this all goes hand in hand with the dismissal of the dangers of radiation to the population, and the reports that come to our popular press all the time, denigrating the dangers of radiation and telling us that everything is okay. And even just today, I saw a piece in the New York Times saying that the health impacts a year after Fukushima indicate that radioactive materials released in Fukushima Daiichi meltdowns will probably be too small to be easily measured, according to experts assembled by the Health Physics Society for a panel discussion on Thursday. This is last Thursday. And the area cordoned off by the Japanese government as uninhabitable is probably far too large, the experts said. So this is directly...
These are industry experts who have money and corporate money and regulations in mind first. There are a lot of independent experts who totally disagree with that. And they weren't put on this panel.
There's a lot of good data that shows that the exposures these people are assuming are much lower than what the people in Japan really got. Now, if you assume a low exposure, then of course you're going to have low cancer rates. But I did those calculations for a living, and there's a series of guesses that the industry's making. And of course, the industry's making all the lowball estimates to get the number down as low as possible. There's a lot of good science coming out, and will continue to come out. We'll have it up on our site. That shows that concentrations of cesium and strontium and all are a lot higher than the industry, quote, experts are assuming. The secret is in the assumptions. If you use lowball assumptions, you're going to get lowball doses. If you go back and really look at the appropriate assumptions, then it's an entirely different analysis.
And need I ask why they would use lowball assumptions?
There's a lot of money here.
Yeah. And also the continuation of the nuclear power industry. Now, there are 54 nuclear power plants in Japan, and 52 are closed down. I believe I read while you were in Japan, Arnie, that they opened up two, or they had the go-ahead to reopen two of the nuclear power plants?
Well, they've done something called a stress test. And two of the power plants have, quote, passed the stress test. And that's, frankly, that's a joke. The stress test, basically, Fukushima could have passed the stress test on March 10th. And it failed on March 11th when reality knocked on the door. The same thing is true for all these power plants. They're just looking to see if they're designed as they were designed. And they're all passing the stress test. In fact, though, if a tsunami is worse than was anticipated, they're not looking at things like loss of the ultimate heat sink and extended loss of ultimate of off-site power. So the stress test is a placebo to make the Japanese feel better about starting the nuclear units up, and the Japanese aren't buying it. At the root of the problem is the regulator, and we talk about that in the report.
Call it a regulatory capture. What is that? That's along the lines of what you were just saying, right?
The regulator, in this case NISA, N-I-S-A, is run by an organization called META, META, and that's a trade cabinet position. So the
Ministry of Energy, Technology, Agent, I think it's Ministry, Energy, Technology Agency, or something like that.
Mm-hmm. So the trade association manages the regulator. And, of course, Tokyo Electric applies pressure at the trade association level, and none of the regulators' regulations ever really have any teeth because of that. It's no different here. I mean, we've got, Congress puts all sorts of pressure on the Nuclear Regulatory Commission to go easy on nuclear utilities as well. This recent hearing where some of the commissioners were upset with the chairman, that made it to a congressional hearing. But what you don't hear is that the ringleader of that, Commissioner Magwood, before he took a job as an NRC commissioner, worked for Tokyo Electric. And now he's chastising the chairman for being too tough.
So this commissioner, this American Nuclear Regulatory Commission, commissioner.
Mm-hmm. Commissioner Magwood.
Magwood worked for Tokyo Electric, which is, I suppose, not just a Japanese company, but a global company.
Right.
Is that it?
Yeah.
He ran a consulting company, and Tokyo Electric was his client. And I'm not sure in what capacity, but Huffington Post did a big piece on it. Commissioner Magwood was objected to by 100 different environmental organizations. They basically felt his appointment was the worst appointment ever for an NRC commissioner. And the Senate and the House unanimously accepted him anyway. That gives you an idea of the pressure that the nuclear utilities put on Congress. So to claim that we're any better than the Japanese.
Unanimously?
Unanimous consent.
You mean our own congressional delegation participated in his endorsement?
It was unanimous consent. And I don't think that means a vote. I think if you don't disagree, it goes through. Nobody disagreed.
Well, that's shocking. I think that we need to have some meetings here in Vermont with Congressman Welch and Senator Sanders and Leahy. It's playing the corporate game.
Definitely.
It's playing right into it.
And Commissioner Magwood also wanted to be head of the commission. Isn't that so?
Yes,
this is
he
something
did.
That I read last December.
Yes.
Yes. Behind the scenes, the industry was saying, well, you don't have to throw Chairman Yasko out. Just make him a commissioner and put Commissioner Magwood in as chairman. So they wanted to revolve the position. So, yeah, the guy that 100 environmental organizations opposed, the industry was lobbying to put in charge of the Nuclear Regulatory Commission. And they almost got their way.
Yeah, and when he didn't get his way, then that was that whole fiasco where he went to Congress with the other commissioners, three of the other commissioners, so four of them, against Chairman Yasko, and they tried to have him removed because they said that he was blocking industry initiatives.
Yes, and in the meantime, they found time to give a 20-year extension to Entergy Vermont Yankee here in Vermont, and they're going around giving extensions.
There's shock on that one, right? On the extension for Vermont Yankee in terms of the NRC, those behind-the-scene notes that came out?
Tell us about that.
Well, of course, the accident occurred on the 11th, and the NRC was about ready to relicense Vermont Yankee for another 20 years, and they put it off for a couple of days, and they wanted to, I think within the NRC they wanted to see if there were any lessons that applied, but another commissioner whose name I can't pronounce, it starts with an S and there's a V in it, and anyway, one of the women commissioners on the NRC commission said, you know, no, it's not going to happen. We've licensed this. It's going through. So on the 16th, 5 days after the accident, Vermont Yankee got its license, even though on the 12th, we've also found an NRC email saying that the Mark I containment, which is what Vermont Yankee has, is the worst containment in the world.
And then there were the internal email that surfaced said, well, was between the commission and the staff. And does this mean that the staff is going to reapprise Vermont Yankee and some of the other plants, Mark I VWRs, in light of the issues at Fukushima? No, this just means we're holding off for political expediency, basically, is what it said. Mm-hmm. That we're just holding off right now until the tenor calms down a little bit.
Going back to the topic, an accident waiting to happen, these are all horribly shocking things that have been going on after Fukushima and before it. And many people also think that our nuclear power reactors here in the United States are accidents ready to happen. Mm-hmm. And your expertise on that Mark I goes back to over 40 years ago. This is just terrible. And at the same time, things are going on, it seems the same as. Like, for example, there was an agreement between England and France recently, the two leaders, Sarkozy and the Prime Minister of England, agreed on Areva on bringing in a more Areva nuclear power reactors to England. And so they seem to be going in lockstep into the future without any kind of a conscience about what has happened.